I'm honored to be here today. A lot of y'all probably don't know about our ministry. These kids down here are amazing. These are what we want our kids to be. Somebody say amen. But I hate to be Debbie Downer. I work with bad kids. I work with the disobedient, the disrespectful, the ones you don't want in the youth group. I'm just being honest. We're hoping that the kids that I work with can see a heart change and then join the youth group. But the ones that I'm working with, you really don't want them, especially you dads. You don't want the guys that I deal with hanging around your daughters, I promise you. Okay? So before we get started, they're going to show another video. It's not as exciting as what we saw about these kids. We're going to show you about some of the kids we work with on a monthly basis. Ready, Glenn?
We were literally looking for military schools and, I mean, whatever it costs. We were at our dire straits with my son.
What we were doing wasn't working, right? So I think just doing something different. Again, you talk about the different consequences that we have. If the child is doing the same thing over and over and over, then obviously you've got to try something different, right?
Do y'all know where you're at right now?
We're on our last leg with Bryson. This literally was the military school was on the books. We are looking at the ones in Charleston. We are looking at the ones in Florida. We are looking.
You know, I think the take everything away short period of time, you know, kind of thinking through that. And, you know, it's kind of like a grounding, but it's someone else kind of reinforcing those rules that parents set in place and reinforcing those consequences, that there are consequences to your actions.
And we're not just simply concerned about your behavior in here. We're concerned about your heart.
Being a teenager today, and like anybody else said, it's much harder than it was when I was growing up. The peer pressure and the friends they have. So I speak a lot about life, about choices, and the choices we make can land us into a bad situation, what it has some of these kids has come through.
I could not even begin to explain the miraculous difference in my child. Mr. Jamie taught him, you know, to try and appreciate what you have, that it could be taken away. But I walked away from here that day from camp being empowered to be his parent, because I had lost that. And that was probably one of the biggest changes for us, was me having the power to be his parent again and make the rules and say, oh yes, you are going to do this.
You know, I know he really did not want to do this, right? So we kind of made the decision about, I'd say about 3 weeks ago. So for the last 3 weeks, it's been, I don't want to go to T-Spot. It's not going to help. There's no point, right? But I think, you know, from what I've seen over the last 24 hours, I think it has been fruitful. You know, there at the end, he stood up. I think the story around the 10 lepers, right? He stood up, started crying, came, gave me a hug, and I started crying. And, you know, it's something that hasn't happened in a while.
His program is biblically based. It's very simple. It gives parents back the power to be a parent and helps us realize that we're not doing our children any favors by letting them get away with things that we know is wrong. I just wish more people would have the courage to come and do this camp, because it would change their life.
We're going to be in Matthew chapter 24 this morning. And I will get to the scriptures in a minute. I'm going to pray as y'all are turning there. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for the opportunity you've given me to be here. Please speak through me, draw me closer to you, and draw your people closer to you this morning, all for the glory of Christ. And it's in his name I pray. Amen. So we just did last weekend our 40th camp. We started in 2018, or 2017, our 40th camp. And I want to tell you a couple of things a lot of y'all have heard me speak before. It's been a year, year and a half since I've been here. And I just want to share, sometimes you just want to quit when you're in the ministry. Where'd Glenn go? He disappeared. He quit too. Sometimes you just want to quit, okay? And about two and a half years ago, I think I told y'all the last time I spoke, we had a young man that we've known for over 20 years that I worked with when he was in high school, and he actually had a confrontation with Anderson County deputies 2 years ago, and they killed him, okay? They ran him off the road. He come out of the car, held a gun up, they killed him. And my wife called me and she said, did you hear what happened to this guy? And I said, no. She sent me the news report. And it was like, we saw that coming when he was in high school. And some of you folks, if you ever work with teenagers, you're thinking, this one's headed down the wrong road. Max sitting there nodding his head. You see them when they're young, you're saying they're heading down a bad path. And so I want to tell y'all about two different instances we had at camp in the past 9 months or so. Back in October, 11:32, and Mac and Coach O'Shields challenged me Wednesday night to preach the shortest message, or a shorter message than Mark Bishop, okay? So I am going to do my best to be short and sweet this morning, all right? Mac gave me the thumbs up. I'm going to go fast. Back in October, we had our first camp that was all girls. All girls. And most of my crew is all guys. I've got a new daughter-in-law now. She comes to camp every month and volunteers, so it's nice having her out there. And then my wife just started. She taught two of our parenting classes last weekend, and that was her first time teaching at camp. So we've got some more of a female presence out there, but all girls. Now, if y'all saw in the video, did y'all see where they were in sleeping bags on the concrete floor? That's where those kids sleep on Friday night. And if they're bad, on Saturday, we go another night. And I love it, young ladies. I love it when the pretty girls come to camp, okay? Because the pretty girls don't get to take showers. They don't get to wear makeup. They sleep on the floor without a pillow. And we have bugs out there that crawl on them and get in their hair. And it is hilarious, okay? And what we're showing them is how good they have it at home. And these parents that treat them like little princesses and treat them like gold, these kids basically put their fist in mom and daddy's face and they say, you don't tell me what to do. That's what they're doing. Well, back in October, we had all girls. And while the kids work all day on Saturday doing manual labor tasks, we have our parenting class going on. And we're wrapping up in the afternoon. And what we started doing last year was we tell the kids on Friday night, if you behave, if you keep your mouth shut, if you work hard, you can go home on Saturday night. Now, that is a huge incentive that they don't have to spend two nights. And when we started doing that, we've not had any runaways, and the kids are usually pretty compliant, because all we got to say is, do you want to go home tonight? And yeah, I want to go home. Then get with the program, get to work. So we've got this dad there at camp, and we had told the kids they could go home. They're all working hard. And we're wrapping up on Saturday afternoon, and the dad says this: I can't get my kid to open up their cell phone. Brad's giving me this look like, yeah, right, okay. I said, what do you mean you can't get her to give you her cell phone? He goes, well, I got her cell phone, but she won't give me the password. I said, where's the phone? He says, it's in the car. I said, go get it. I'll get the password for you. Now, he's on his way out, and he says, now, hold on a second. Now, this is the dad speaking. Don't you tell my daughter that she can't go home tonight if I don't get the password. Why didn't he want me to do that? He wanted to go home. He didn't want to be there. And I said, excuse me, sir, this is Camp T-Spot 36 or 35. I said, I've done this a few times. Let me do my job. So we're wrapping up, and y'all have heard me share this before. We do Jesus and the 10 Lepers to close out camp every month. And we talk about being grateful for what you have and being grateful for, I say, what would you do if you were Jesus and only one leper came back to thank you? And they said, I'd kill him. I'd give the other nine leprosy. I said, well, thank you for being honest. What should your parents do to you? And we talk about all the things that their parents give them. And so this little girl, she breaks down and she starts crying. She's 16 years old. And we see the mom and the dad and the daughter, they're all hugging and crying and things are working out. And she comes back and sits down and I hold up her cell phone. And she got these big eyes and I said, what's this? She said, that's my phone. I said, I said, won't you give me the password? She said, I can't do that. I said, how come? She said, there's stuff on there I don't want you to see. I said, well, I don't want to see it. I said, what stuff are you talking about? Now, you parents, you think I'm crazy. You ask your kids about this, okay? Sheila Lee, remember the last time I asked you to ask your kid about something in a parenting class? I asked Grayson one day back there in the fellowship hall, walking through one of our classes. I said, Grayson, you know where you can get drugs at Landrum High School? He said, yes, sir. His mama looked at him like, Grayson, what? He said, Mom, everybody knows where to get pot around here. I said, give me your password. She said, I can't. I said, how come? She said, there's stuff on there I don't want you to see. I said, what kind of stuff? She said, there's pictures and videos of me and my boyfriend. High school age kid making homemade pornography. Now, I know none of these kids do stuff like that. But I'd be willing to bet they know some people at the local high school that talk about stuff like this. Because they say 40% of the young people in the local high schools are doing stuff like this. And y'all know what the parents are? They're just clueless. I know not none of y'all, okay? But all the other parents in Spartanburg County. So I said, I looked at her, I said, give me the password now. She gave me the password. I took the phone and I threw it to her dad. He said, I don't want to see that. I said, you said you wanted the password. Here's the password. Your phone's open now. He looked at his daughter. Now, what would you do, Dad? What would you do? I'd kill somebody. Probably the boy in the video. No amens on that one, huh? This is what the dad said. It broke my heart. He said, Mr. Jamie asks us at the end of camp every month to forgive our kids for what they've done, and we're going to leave here with a fresh start. And the dad said, I don't care what's on that video. Don't want to see it. I forgive you. I hope that you'll seek the Lord's forgiveness, and we're going to go forward. Praise God. The kids are saying praise God. Yeah. Yeah. Mom and Dad, please forgive me, all right? Then I want to tell you about another camp experience that we just had, and this was 2 months ago, and this is where my message is coming from, and my message is going to be short and sweet, I promise. Max, say amen. Amen. 2 months at camp, we had this kid show up, and he was a big boy. He liked to eat, okay? What you laughing at? He was a big boy. He's also the child of a criminal. And the kids at his school knew about his parent that was in trouble with the law. So we have this kid that is a big boy. rough family situation. And y'all know, our kids don't pick on other kids because they're First Baptist kids, right? And they love Jesus. They praise the Lord, right, Glenn? But them other heathen kids that don't come to First Baptist, guess what they do to kids like that? They pick on them. And so this kid, he had all kinds of self-esteem issues, rebelliousness. He had given his mom fits for a long time. And so we're going through the camp, and it was kind of interesting. We cut up some trees, and we had them split up, and the trees were at the bottom of the hill, and our stack station was at the top of the hill, and we had the kids walking back and forth. I told them one piece of wood at a time. Okay? So Big Boy got some exercise that day, and he was hurting that afternoon. It was pretty rough. And he was gonna be given the opportunity to go home on Saturday night. We had two other kids that they were spending the night no matter what. So Mr. Jamie was spending the night no matter what. And we told this young man at about 3 or 4 o'clock, we said, okay, here's the deal. You've done good today. You've worked hard. He was dry heaving. He was hurt, and I guess he couldn't handle the heat that weekend either. And his mom, one of the things that this kid struggled with was he wouldn't take a shower. So not only was he a big boy, kind of lazy, picked on about his family situation, and he stunk too. Okay. Kids, I want you to understand something. If you don't take showers, you stink, okay? Especially you boys, all right? So we told the kid, here's the deal. His mama had two requests. He had to promise he would take a shower. So I said, if you'll take a shower, you can go home. And then he also had a CPAP machine that he refused to wear, and his mama was scared he was going to die. And I said, you have to promise me you're going to wear your CPAP machine tonight. And I said, and if you refuse, your mama knows. They only live 15 minutes from where we were. I said, your mama can bring you back to camp. He said, yes, sir. He took a shower, and he went home, and we never heard from him again. I called a couple of days later to check on him. The mom was raving about her new kid. Okay? But when mom was at camp, now this is my message, okay? And it's going to come from Matthew 24, verse 12. I'll read that. Y'all know what Matthew 24 is? It's when the disciples ask Jesus, when's the end of the world going to take place? And Jesus is telling them, and in verse 12, he said this. He says, and because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. Do we see that today? Iniquity, lawlessness, wickedness, does that abound today? Yes. I've heard a preacher say in the past that if God doesn't judge America, he owes Sodom and Gomorrah an apology. There's some truth to that. Though I would never tell God he owed anybody anything. So Jesus is warning us that when iniquity abounds today, the love of many will become cold. Now I want to ask y'all this question real quick. I know it's 11:45. We're going. Promise. Tell me the opposite of these words. Day. Light. Fast, skinny, love, wrong. No, you're wrong, okay? The opposite of love is not hate. The opposite of love is apathy. And we do more damage. Not our church, but everybody else's church, okay? We do more damage with apathy than we do with hate. Now, what are you talking about? Well, while we were going through the parenting class for the chunky kid at camp, his mom made this statement. She said, "My son has been giving me problems for over 2 years." And she said, "I was talking about it one day," and she said, "My sister knew what I was going through for the past 2 years, and she knew about you. And she never told me about this camp that was 15 minutes from my house." Now, here's my message. What about us? And I ain't talking about me. I ain't talking about my ministry. I'm not talking about Camp T-Spot, the Proactive Parenting Initiative. That's not what I'm talking about. What do we know that the world needs to know that we don't share the good news? Do we have the truth? Do we have the answers to all the world's problems? It's all right here. And what do? We keep it to ourselves. And in the very next chapter, Jesus is talking about separating the sheep from the goats in the end. And he's giving out the rewards to the sheep. And he's saying that you fed me, you clothed me, you visited me in prison. You took care of me when I was hurting. And they said, "When did we do that?" And he said, "When you did it unto the least of these, you did it unto me." And then he asked the goats, or he tells the goats, "You're being judged for not doing these things." And they said, "Well, when did we see you like this?" "When you didn't do it to the least of these." And my challenge is this: how often do we hear of needs that need to be fulfilled? How often do we hear from people that need help? And we just think somebody else will do it. I don't hate those people, but because I don't do anything, somebody suffers. Do you get the picture? In closing, Max, amen. In closing, we're going to do things a little different today. My favorite song that my wife sings is a song that wraps up this message. And in closing, she's going to sing that, and then we're turning it over to Glenn.
Didn't have to leave the glory of heaven, but you became a simple man. You didn't have to serve the poor and afflicted, yet you touched and healed their brokenness. No greater love has been given. You became the ultimate sacrifice. Create in me the heart of a servant. Let this be my soul's desire. Show me how to love in the true meaning of the word. Teach me to sacrifice, expecting nothing in return. I want to give my life away, becoming more like you each and every day. My words are not enough. Show me how to love. A bruised and battered woman with hungry children on the street. Then I heard you ask in that still small voice, "What have you done for the least of these?" Lord, consume me with a burning fire that melts away my complacency. be moved, love and compassion, then someone will find the way in me and show me how to love in the true meaning of the word. Teach me to sacrifice, expecting nothing in return. I want to give my life away, becoming more like you each and every day. My words are not enough, show me how to love. Open up my eyes that I might clearly see. Of me, thine loving me, unlovable, and touching me, untouchable.